All right, so what they're asking for this problem is they say, fill in the information below for the rational function. If that information is applied, right, not applicable, then sketch the graph and its asymptote. So we need to sketch this graph, right? So the first thing, ladies and gentlemen, I'm always going to be doing, rather than even worrying about what information I need to apply, I always want to look, is this at least even factorable? All right? Can I factor anything out? And we look at this problem, we say, all right, we have a trinomial over here, right? We have x squared plus 4x minus 5. Well, that can be factored into x plus 5 times x minus 1. Correct?
Correct.
So let's go and rewrite this in factored form. OK. By writing this in factored form, what we notice, ladies and gentlemen, is that the x plus 5 over the x plus 5 are going to divide into 1. Right? Therefore, actually leaving us a function that's going to look like this. OK? We'll talk a little bit more about this in a second. So first of all, there's a couple points that we needed to take about. This now looks like a reciprocal function, right? Do you remember when we talked about graphing? We said f of x equals 1 over x. That was the parent graph for the reciprocal function, which looked like this. Yes, we talked about parent graphs. This was the reciprocal function. And remember, there's two asymptotes. You had a horizontal asymptote at y equals 0, and you had a vertical asymptote at y equals 0. So what we learned how to graph with these was that you can apply your transformations with this graph. So what we notice is we have this minus 1. That, remember, is your x minus h, right? Remember, we write this formula, and our standard position looked like this. A times 1 over x minus h plus k. So we need to say, all right, what are my transformations then for this function? Well, I have minus 1, which means your h is now going to shift to the right one. And then minus 2 tells you you're going to shift down 2. So by sketching the graph, what I notice is now, rather than trying to shift this whole graph, we know that my asymptotes are now going to be shifting 1 over and down 2. Yes? OK. Now, we notice that the asymptote is equal at 1, because obviously that when it makes it, that's going to make my denominator 0. So the first thing it asks is, you know, what are your discontinuities? We notice that this graph is discontinuous. Now, one thing that I showed you guys, so if we sketch the graph, it's going to look something like this. Right? So when we sketch the graph, you guys can see your two points. Now, the one thing I mentioned to you guys, as far as creating the table, you can just pick other points to plug in, right? So if we have 1, you could plug in what's 2, what's 3. You could do what point is 0 and at negative 1. That's going to be for your table of values. All right? I'm not going to, so to show you guys that, we could say, so you do xy table. All right? And if we do an xy table, you could say, all right, well, we know 1, it's discontinuous, but what it happens at 2. So you plug 2 in for x. So 2 minus 1 is 1. 1 divided by 1 is 1. 1 minus 1, 1 minus 2 is negative 1. And then do 3. So remember, I asked you guys to always complete a table of values to provide at least 2 points to the right of the asymptote and 2 points to the left of the vertical asymptote. So at 3 would be 3 minus 2. 3 minus 1 is 2. So 1 divided by 2 is 1 half. So 1 half minus 2 would be negative 1.5. Yes? 1 half? OK. Then you guys could plug in 0. Because now 0 would be to the left of the vertical asymptote. So you plug 0 in for x. 1 divided by 0 minus negative 1 is negative 1. 1 minus negative 1 is negative 1. Negative 1 minus 2 is negative 3. And then plug in 1. Obviously, we know 1 doesn't work, right? Because that makes it 0. So let's do 2, or negative 2. No, I'm sorry. Let's do negative 1. I don't know, but we can just hold on for what I'm doing. It doesn't matter what points I want to pick. I can pick negative 10. It doesn't matter. So if I pick, why am I picking? Why? I want to pick negative 1. So if I pick negative 1 back here, ladies, what I'll have is negative 1 minus 1 is negative 2. 1 minus negative 2 is going to be a negative 1 half. So negative 1 half minus 2 is going to be a negative 2.5. All right? So what I just did, ladies and gentlemen, is I've graphed a couple things. First of all, I sketched the graph by moving the asymptotes according to our transformations, right? Then I verified my graph by at least plotting these two points. So I go over negative, so I go over 2 down to negative 1. That's where the graph actually goes through. And then 3, negative 5. So 1, 2, 3 down negative 1.5. So actually the graph gonna kind of looks like this. So I'm gonna want to verify my points. Over here, I go 0 goes to negative 3. And then at negative 1, it's negative 2.5. So this graph actually looks something like this. All right? It's a little bit closer to the asymptotes than I originally sketched. All right? So when you're taking your graph, you're going to want to make sure that, yes, you sketch the graph, but also you provide 2 points to the left and 2 points right. All you do is just pick your points closest to your asymptote and just plug them into the formula to get their output value. Okay? So just by sketching the graph, what your graphing calculator looks like, that's great. You're still going to have to verify what the points are. Okay. So now let's go and answer these questions. So it asks us, what is the removable discontinuity? So ladies and gentlemen, right now you see this graph, right? We know that this graph is discontinuous at the value of 1, right? You cannot keep your pencil on drawing this graph and graph this whole graph without having to lift it up and move it over here to finish up graphing it, right? So it's discontinuous at 1. Why is it discontinuous at 1? Well, if we go back to the function, you could say that when you put a 1 in for there, it's 0, right? Which means it's undefined. But is that the only number in our original function which makes it undefined? No. The other number would be at negative 5. At negative 5, this graph is also discontinuous. But how is negative 5 and positive 1 different? Well, negative 5 we factored out, right? So it's still discontinuous at negative 5, but we can remove it. So therefore, when your discontinuity, your removable discontinuity is x cannot equal negative 5. That is removable because you factored it out. So how is it what is it going to look like then? What does a removable discontinuity look like? So at negative 5, 1, 2, 3, 4, 5, it's not in my final graph form, right? We removed it. But it's still a discontinuity in this function. So what we do is we put an open circle there. Because the graph is still discontinuous at negative 5. However, it does not affect the shape of my graph once it's been factored out. All right? So now my non-removable discontinuity was my x minus 1, because I cannot remove that, right? The x minus 1 still stays. So that's my non-removable discontinuity. When I look at vertical asymptote, we say it's x equals 1. My horizontal asymptote is x equals negative 2. My domain is going to be all real values except x cannot equal 1 and x cannot equal negative 5. And my range is going to be all real numbers except x cannot equal negative 2. OK? That was number 16. All right.